Minnesota, the heart of the most productive agricultural nation in the world. Each year, the land brings forth new wealth. A good harvest was once cause for celebration, but there's no more rejoicing here. Despite record production, American family farm income has been cut in half since the 70s. The producers of our food are becoming eligible for food stamps. For thousands of farmers, this is the last harvest.
There are many farms that are not going to be saved. And the lending institutions keep using the word wipeout, that they expect a lot of farms to be lost this coming fall and this spring.
Trouble on the land means trouble for the small businesses and communities that depend on family farms. All across America, a way of life that people have worked generations to build is coming apart piece by piece. But while some move away in quiet despair, others refuse to give up.
If you live here, it means a lot to you. If it's your home, it's your workplace, it's the future for your children for most people.
Farmers are angry and coming together in numbers unseen since the Great Depression to save the life they love.
It's up to people who live on the land and others who perhaps want to be there. It's up to those to stick together and fight to stay there.
This is the story of three farmers, three women who share new hope for the heartland.
Breakfast is ready any time.
Okay, I'm on the East End right now. It'll be about 5 minutes.
Okay, it'll be ready.
Ann and Chuck Canton grow wheat, barley, soybeans, and sugar beets in western Minnesota. Three generations of Cantons have plowed this ground.
Good morning. Are you freezing?
Yes, it's cold.
Ann and Chuck know their land intimately and treat it with loving care. They hope their son Kent, the oldest of their three children, can keep farming here. The Cantons took the advice of experts who said expand for the coming boom in agriculture. They bought more land and bigger machines, but expansion was not the answer. They are hardworking, efficient, productive farmers, but they are going deeper into debt.
After farming on this farm for some over 20 years, Chuck and I looked at one another and realized, you know, there is something wrong. There is something wrong. Is it us? And are we just doing everything wrong on this place? Or what's happening to us in our small town and to some of our neighbors?
Seed, fuel, fertilizer, machinery, credit. The Cantons' costs have tripled in the past 10 years. They spend more than $6 to produce a bushel of wheat, but at harvest must sell it for less than $4. A few giant grain companies dominate the market. The only choice the Cantons have is to sell or wait, hoping for a higher price. But for them, farming is more than a business. It's a way of life. So even though their economic losses mount, they go deeper into debt, mortgaging their land for the cash to keep farming.
Not very long ago, Chuck had to go and borrow money to pay the interest on the borrowed money. And I know he looked at the banker and said, you know, you begin to wonder, you know, are we the only ones that are going through this? And the banker just laughed. And he said, there are many, many, many.
As long as land values rose, farmers survived. But land prices are falling now, and credit is drying up.
What are the economists?
Every week, more than 100 Minnesota family farms must sell out or face foreclosure. The Cantons know they are living on borrowed time.
I'm only 45, now 50, now 50, now 50, anybody 50, anybody 50, anybody 50. I'm only 45, now 50. How about a 47 and a half. I'm only 45, now 47 and a half, now 50.
$60 on 50, 60 on 50, dollars 60, $60 on 50, 60, 50 on 50, 60, $50, 60, 50, on 5. 55 on $50, 5 on 55, on $50, 5 on 55.
An auction is not easy for farmers to watch. In the past 30 years, they have said goodbye to more than half of their neighbors. But not since the Great Depression have so many auctions come so often. So many lives been changed forever. So many dreams died so suddenly.
All in all, done. Fair warning, number 53. Sold the tractor, $15,200. Number 110 buys it.
It's just so wrong, I think, for this nation that expects all the abundance and all the good things in the supermarkets and in the stores, and yet that the people who are here and doing it and working the 12, the 14, maybe 16 hours a day, 7 days a week, can't make it.
God came to Moses through the burning bush. He said, I realize the suffering that your people are going through in Egypt. And he said, Moses, go to Pharaoh. That's where the military and the political decisions are made. And what that little story says to me is that we indeed have a responsibility to challenge the pharaohs.
Tom says that we could get all this business settled real quick if we get 5,000 women, arm them with a rolling pin, and send them to Washington, D.C. He said,
where does the plane take the hole?
In 1977, Anne and a small group of farm women heard about a new farm organization, the American Agriculture Movement.
The whole thrust and idea was that we can do something about it ourselves. And it's at the point where we have to do something, that we can no longer rely on the experts. If we want to survive on this land, it's up to the people of the land to do it.
Right here. They began to organize meetings, small at first, but larger as farmers heard that others were demanding a fair price and a living wage.
It just got more exciting, and we got to the point where we were organized enough to put together a march on the Capitol in St. Paul. Because I'd never protested bodily, ever, to say that I, as a farmer, was protesting. It was scary for me, but it was also terribly exciting. And the next step then was to say something nationally. We arrived at Washington early in the morning, found our way to Capitol Hill, finally found a place to park, walked for blocks, came around the corner of the Capitol of the United States,
and saw 40,000 farmers. I cried. Couldn't believe it. I remember how good that was for Chuck. Because he grabbed me and he said, "We aren't the only ones."
I've been talking to them congressmen, I thought you know. I've been talking to them senators way down that road. Said, "I'm tired of all your lies, bribes, and corporate ties. I've been doing some hard traveling low."
A year later, in January 1979, they were back, this time with their tractors. They demanded federal policies that would guarantee a fair price for farm products and the survival of the family farm.
We found out that we could walk into senators' offices and congressmen's offices and we could talk to them. We knew what the issues were and we could say it straight and strong and hopefully get them to understand. And of course, they didn't understand.
But Moses had to go many times. It was the 10th time that Pharaoh finally agreed, and he said, "Go, take your people."
Oklahoma, Nebraska, Kansas, Texas, North Dakota, Colorado, when the agricultural states speak together, we shall say, "Thou shalt not steal the gifts from our land. And we shall have a prosperous and healthy America again."
Maybe it's unpredictable. Maybe something will happen. As long as we're still on the land, there's always a chance. And that's what we have to keep fighting for.
The Cantons' farm and thousands of others are threatened by economic pressures. But the fabric of rural America is being torn by other forces as well. 3 million acres of precious farmland are lost each year to suburban sprawl, highways, pipelines, strip mines, and hazardous waste. It was a power line that threatened Ellis Tripp's farm in central Minnesota. Ellis and John Tripp were not always farmers. They moved to the farm after living in big cities.
We worked long, long hours. When we first came, our hands, I haven't worn a wedding ring since I've been here because my hands got so big I couldn't get it on.
That's good.
We've loved it, so that it's very, very dear to us and very, very important. The first year we were here, somebody asked John what he missed about the city. And he said, "All I miss is the dirty, filthy, smoky money."
After 20 years of dairy farming, the Tripps were ready to settle down to a quiet retirement when two utilities announced plans to run a power line across their land. Stretching 450 miles from North Dakota to Minneapolis, it was, at that time, the highest voltage power line ever proposed. The Tripps and other farmers believed the line would damage their health, crops, and livestock. But when they met with the utilities, the only choice they were offered was to sell the land in the line's path or see it condemned.
And at that first meeting, when people, neighbors got up who never spoke in public and they spoke to this group of bureaucrats and lawyers who were really giving them the cold shoulder and really spilled out their guts to these people and told about their deep feelings about their land and how frightened they were of the whole idea because it was so unknown and such a big technology being
pushed off on them. Well, I got so excited that very night that I talked, and I talked so fast they couldn't even transcribe it. And John talked, and all of a sudden he forgot that he was shy, and he's been talking ever since.
The Tripps and their neighbors, with little money or experience, petitioned, wrote letters, and found themselves face to face with the utilities lobby.
People went in busloads to the Capitol. We went to hearings. We went to, stayed up late at night at legislative hearings, and nobody listened to us. The legislators, the governor, the attorney general, there's nothing I can do. That's their answer. Why can't you have a moratorium? Well, we'd be sued, is what they said. That's our government being intimidated by this utility, being afraid to take the action that the people demand because they might be sued, and that is a very weak government.
Public authorities gave the go-ahead. Construction began. Throughout the winter of 1978, hundreds of farmers stood in front of surveyors, blocked roads and fields, and confronted work crews. The governor called out the state patrol. Tension rose, tempers flared. John Tripp and several other farmers were arrested. Other protesters sprayed themselves with pig manure to hinder arrest. And on one cold January day, Alice Tripp blocked a survey crew and was arrested.
They put me in the patrol car and I just jumped out the other side. But finally I got put in jail. And John said, gee, what a night. So I came home to milk the cows and the hired man is drunk and you're in jail.
Despite months of protest and 100 arrests, the land was condemned and the line was completed.
You feel helpless against the forces that run the country, and you wonder where your government is, and you have a great fear that maybe you have lost, and you're very angry and very unhappy about it. So when I went to jail, I wasn't ashamed. I was still angry, and I was hoping to make a statement. I don't know if I did or not. Ordinarily, I used to cry if a policeman stopped me to give me a traffic ticket. I was that intimidated by the police. Not anymore. You change, boy. Once you've been stepped on hard enough, you feel for the rest of the people who are being stepped on. And you realize you can't stay home and milk the cows and make hay. You've got to get out and do something about it.
And I think Dick is really...
Outspoken and decisive, Alice became a local leader. Her neighbors asked her to run for governor of Minnesota to keep alive their concerns about land.
It was so new to us, such a foreign idea to, you know, to have Alice run for anything, but especially for governor in the primary.
I was sort of thinking about the library board.
Our party is made of workers.
Alice received a surprising 20% of the vote for governor, and she went on to the 1980 Democratic National Convention to speak for family farmers.
Why are you paying too much for your groceries if the farmer is getting so little? Farm income is predicted to drop as much as 40% this year. But General Foods and General Mills report profit increases of 20 to 30%. We must break up the partnership between government and big corporations.
You don't want to appear to be just angry. You want to appear to be knowledgeable. Maybe angry, but more knowledgeable than angry.
Alice Tripp and her neighbors still meet regularly. They monitor the effects of the power line that crosses their land and try to help other farmers who face threats to their way of life. Their work has helped prevent new lines from being built in Minnesota and other states. Alice has no plans to stop her activity, and her tenacity brings hope to young farmers like Patty Kakek. Patty Kakek grew up with 9 brothers and sisters on a 70-acre farm in central Minnesota.
It was pretty. Then a highway came through, right through the middle of the farm, without our having much say about it. I don't think we were ready to give it up at that time, but there was no choice in the matter. They just came and started surveying. It completely divided the farm. And that's when we came out to where we are right now. It was always assumed that my brothers would take over the farm. So when I grew up, I left the farm and went to school and became a nurse. The city seemed lonely to me. I got tired of the noise, traffic, people. I missed the quietness. That's what drew me back.
When Patty returned to her brother's farm, she faced the same problems that plagued both Ann Canton and Alice Tripp.
Even my brothers, who had expanded like most other farmers did, felt like they were getting further and further behind. They were spending more on bigger machinery, more cows, always striving to get better and better crops so that they could get a better living. And it somehow, it wasn't working out. It wasn't making life better. It wasn't making them any more independent. It wasn't, it seemed like they were farming more and more for the loan companies, for the chemical companies, for the feed companies. And at that time, of course, the power line started coming through, and I started getting involved in that. That was a way that I could directly vent my frustrations and feeling that I could somehow stop farmland from being taken from something beyond our control. I was watching TV and I saw that they arrested Alice, and it just made me so mad that they could do this to an older woman who was loved by so many, and she was a farm woman.
Day after day, Patty joined the protesters in the fields. Finally, she too was arrested.
I would have never dreamed that I would have gotten arrested. And even at the time that I did it, I was shocked at myself for doing it. But now, I probably would do it again.
During that winter, Patty found a kindred spirit and a warm friend in Alice Tripp.
She would always come up to me and tell me to speak out and say, you have a good way of speaking. You have something. I like what you say.
Patty and Alice crisscrossed Minnesota from county fair to county fair when Alice ran for governor.
It was in the midst of working on Alice's campaign that I met Ann Canton. She was speaking to a large group, and I was part of the audience. And as I was sitting there listening, I thought Ann Canton was saying what I felt. And I think a lot of other farm women felt the same way. My being able to connect with older women like Alice and Ann, it makes me feel that even though things are difficult, perhaps, you know, I'm going to be able to be on the land. Maybe I won't be able to make a big change. Maybe by the time I'm 80, or maybe in the next generations, things aren't going to be a whole lot different, but they might be just a little bit different.
Farmers have always looked to the southwest skies for signs of bad weather. A single hailstorm can ruin a year's work. But today there are greater threats than the weather, and farmers now look to each other in their hope to harvest tomorrow.
You may be a doctor, you may be a lawyer, you may be a carpenter too, but somewhere back in your family tree, you were a farmer too. Come, oh, come hear me now. Hear my story I'll tell. Take care of this land or it will be gone. This land we love so well. From this earth we do come. Back to this earth we return. To survive we must take care of our roots. This lesson we all must learn. Come, oh, come hear me now. Hear my story I tell. Take care of this land or it will be gone. This land we love so well. Take care of this land or it will be gone.